Hi. I'm going to play the computer chess, listen to Ravi Zacharias. He's a really good preacher, Indian, and really good preacher. And also listen to strange music.
It's to wrestle with the issues of our time. May God bless you, and you have a wonderful new year. May 2017 bring you great joys and great opportunities to serve the Lord. So in the light of that, my message tonight is entitled, The Passing
and the Abiding. I'm going to play the medium because it's fast
that way. The Passing and the Abiding. What will always come to pass,
I'm white, and the computer is black.
Forever. I'll never forget some years ago, quite a few years ago now, when my first daughter, my oldest child, Sarah, we live in Atlanta, and she was at Covenant College in Lookout Mountain. And my wife and
okay,
Sarah,
when it does that, I'll just, when it goes blank like that, I'll go to Ravi. Yeah, I'll go to Ravi here. Oh, it's back already. Okay.
Margie was staying on an extra day, but because I was flying out for some meetings, I left. I was totally unprepared for the emotions. Completely unprepared. And as I pulled away from the front of her place where she was going to stay in the dorm, I still vividly remember her standing behind the screen door. And as I got onto Interstate 75, I couldn't last more than about 5 to 7 minutes. I had to pull over onto the side and let my heart just express the emotions. And one of the songs that came to my mind was that one, is this the little girl I carry? Is that the little boy at play? I don't remember growing older. When did they? How did she get to be a beauty? How did they get to be so tall? All those beautiful lines. And how seedlings turn overnight to sunflowers, blossoming even as we gaze. It was a moment to remember, a hinge moment in your life that changes come and they are emotionally laden. Yes, it is a change we had to expect. And no, it was not a grievous change, but it was an emotional one to remind us that time inexorably moves on. Only the eternal word abides forever. God has given us a calendar, and I often am asked by somebody sitting in an audience to be very philosophical, and they say, what is time? And I give them a very simple answer. It is this. It is a calibration of change. You measure change, whether it's the clock or whether it's the calendar. Time goes on and we measure change, and time is that necessary component in that. But as I ponder the whole reality of change, I keep thinking of how the swirling emotions take over through those first process of changes. America is in a process of change. Many are not willing to accept it, because they want things the way they've always wanted things. But time moves on, change comes, and God reminds us that the glory of the Christian life is in knowing how to handle change. And I want to talk about three of those changes, but one of those attitudes towards change can be very fatalistic, or a pie in the sky by and by when I die. It was James Whitcomb Riley in his poem, A Life Lesson, who says this, there, little girl, don't cry. They have broken your doll, I know, and your tea set blue and your playhouse too are things of the long ago, but childish troubles will soon pass by. There, little girl, don't cry. There, little girl, don't cry. They have broken your slate, I know, and the glad wild ways of your schoolgirl days are the things of long ago, but life and love will soon come by. There, little girl, don't cry. There, little girl, don't cry. They have broken your heart, I know. And the rainbow gleams of your youthful dreams are things of the long ago. But heaven holds all for which you sigh. There, little girl, don't cry. whether it's the doll or the slate or the broken heart, we seem to keep pushing it forward. Maybe heaven, heaven, heaven will have it all, and the brokenness will always follow us in this world. But God gives us a perspective of how to leverage and how to harness the now. I would like to bring to you three of the greatest changes that God brings into our lives, one or two of them in which we had absolutely no choice, and a couple of them in which we will have a choice. I remember years ago coming back from a cruise in Alaska, and you go through the Seymour Narrows, and the captain of that cruise ship had gotten to know me as we were taking that cruise, and so he brought me over to the bridge, and at that point he takes over. No second in command is piloting that huge vessel at that time, and he told me why. He said, the tallest mountains from below the waters are right here. It is a mariner's nightmare, and he was showing it to me on the radar screen. They are almost at a standstill pace, moving and navigating very carefully, every person at their station as the captain moves it along. And I thought of the hymn in my younger days as we used to sing, Jesus Savior, Savior, pilot me over life's tempestuous seas, unknown waves before me roll, hiding rock and treacherous shoal. Chart and compass come from thee, Jesus Savior, pilot me. Some of you may have lost some loved ones last year, and Christmas was not the happiest of moments for you. We will be, if the Lord spares us, celebrating Christmas next, this coming year. But none of us knows who will be with us and who will not be with us. That's the chart and compass that to which we look. In fact, straight from here, tomorrow morning I'm flying to Houston. My colleague Nabil Qureshi, many of you may have read his book, Seeking Allah, Finding Jesus, in his early 30s, strapping, handsome, powerful conversion story. Such a persuasive speaker, just a few months ago was shocked to literally to his very bones when he found out he had stage 4 cancer of the stomach, and the doctor didn't give him very good chances of surviving that. He's at the MD Anderson Clinic in Houston, and I fly from here tomorrow morning to go and spend the afternoon with him. We never know what news lies ahead. And this is not to paint a grim picture, it's just to remind us that time inexorably moves on. We have things that come and go, and the chart and compass must come from our Savior, who will pilot us through the most treacherous areas of life. And that's the promise he holds for us. And so what are the three changes that come to us that bring to us this reminder? The first, you may think is obvious, it's so obvious that we miss it. It's coming from non-existence to existence. There once was a time where you were not, and then there was a time where you came into being. Only of the Son of God, it says, unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. The Son was not born, the Son eternally existed, he was given, the child was born. But you and I had a time where we were not, and then were called into being. It is David who says this remarkably, for you created me in my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place. When I was woven together in the depths of the earth, your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before even one of them came to be. How precious to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them. You and I are in the thoughts of God. How vast to me are these thoughts, how precious, how fearfully and wonderfully we are made. David said that, and his son Solomon said, God's ways are as mysterious as the pathway of the wind and as the manner in which a human spirit is infused into the little body of a baby while it is yet in its mother's womb. David goes on to say, O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is thy name in all the earth. Who has set thy glory above thy heavens? Out of the mouths of babes and sucklings have you ordained strength. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you've ordained, what is man that you are mindful of him, or the son of man that you visit him? For you've made him a little lower than the angels, and you've crowned him with glory and honor. O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. You see, your name is of value because of the name of the one who formed you.
I'm going to turn Zachary off for a little bit here. Just letting you know that
is on your soul and mind.
The computer is very easy for me to beat. Yeah. It wasn't so about 3 weeks ago, but now it's like taking candy from a baby. I'll continue playing this great preacher, Ravi Zacharias, in the next series of games with the computer. But...